Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Crosses of Iron, the tragic story of Dawson, New Mexico, and its twin mining disasters, by Nick Pappas. Foreword by Richard Meltzer. Narrated by Paul Brion. In the foothills of some mountains, there's a little camp where I was raised. This camp witnessed my birth. It is where I lived a happy life. The years passed me by as though it was a dream in the night. It was the most wonderful dream which I have ever dreamed. While I live, I will never forget. Oh, my beloved Dawson, when will I ever see you again? You were my loving cradle, which gave me my life, which brought me enchantment and gave me my existence. Wherever I will go, I will tell this story to the world. You were a beloved camp, and because of my love for you, I shall never forget you. Allá en las faldas de unas montañas está un campito donde me crié. Ese campito me vio nacer y en él mi vida feliz pasé. Allí los años se me pasaron como una noche y un sueño fue. Sueño tan lindo que yo he soñado, nunca en mi vida lo olvidaré. Ay, mi Dawson tan querido, cuando te volveré a ver. Fuiste mi cuna querida, que me dio la vida, que me dio el encanto, que me dio mi ser. Por donde quiera que yo camino, al mundo le he de contrar. Que fuiste un campo querido, y por lo tanto que te quiero. Nunca, nunca te olvidaré. Agustín Hernández, Farewell to Dawson, Adios a Dawson. Lyrics provided by Roberta Hernández Perez. Foreword, Richard Meltzer. Long before there were oil wells, gas lines, uranium mines, wind farms, or solar panels, coal was the number one source of energy in New Mexico. The coal industry helped produce energy for homes, factories, and railroads, not only in the state, but far beyond. Companies as small as the Albuquerque and Cerrillos Coal Company, and as large as the Phelps Dodge Corporation, built whole communities to facilitate the mining of their coal and provided housing of various quality for their workers. Company towns dotted the New Mexico landscape in McKinley County to the west, Colfax County in the northeast, and Santa Fe County in the north-central region of the state. With time, each company town enjoyed its own identity and sources of pride. Madrid was known for its spectacular Christmas displays. Many camps held extravagant 4th of July celebrations. Some fielded fine athletic teams. Most towns were proud of the children their citizens raised and the successful careers they pursued, from judges and engineers to army colonels and Catholic priests. Dawson is remembered as the largest, most modern of New Mexico's many company towns. Owned and operated by Phelps Dodge, Dawson's coal mine served as the major supplier of cooking fuel for the corporation's valuable copper smelting plants in southern Arizona. With good housing, reputable schools, a large mercantile store, a popular amusement hall, a hospital, a bank, and amicable labor management relations, most employees were proud of their model town and to be residents of it. A mixture of nationalities and ethnicities learned to appreciate and respect each other's cultures as fellow workers and neighbors. Dawson was a highly desirable place to live, especially compared to many less appealing towns in New Mexico and the rest of the country. But like all coal towns, Dawson was also a place of extreme potential danger. No matter its location, coal mining remained among the most dangerous jobs of the late 19th and early 20th centuries. The best most miners could hope for was that their companies maintained strict safety regulations, provided modern safety equipment, and conducted regular safety drills. With narrow profit margins, small companies were less able to invest in such protective measures. Statistically, the odds of experiencing a major mining disaster were therefore highest when working for small, money-strapped companies, and lowest when employed by large, profitable operations. Knowing that it was advantageous for both its business and its workers, companies like Phelps Dodge took pride in protecting the safety of their mines and their miners. Phelps Dodge's interest in safety became a major benefit in recruiting and retaining good miners. Aging photographs show Dawson's miners attending safety classes and participating in drills, using the most modern procedures and equipment. It therefore came as a terrible shock when the Phelps Dodge operation in Dawson faced not one, but two major catastrophes in the course of 10 years. How could a corporation and workforce so well prepared suffer some of the worst mining disasters in New Mexico history? What caused the 1913 and 1923 mine explosions, leaving 383 men dead? How did the company, the industry, the town, and New Mexico react to the crises at the moments they occurred and in their aftermath? What impact did the explosions have on individual lives and on Dawson as a whole, particularly as the town faced other challenges, from the ravages of the Great Depression to competition with more modern fuels? These are the questions that journalist Nick Pappas answers in one of the best-written, most thoroughly researched histories ever published on mining disasters in American history. As a prize-winning veteran newspaper writer and editor, Pappas is the ideal author to tell this story with precision, compassion, and engaging prose. Dawson is now a ghost town, but unlike most ghost towns, it has no old buildings or abandoned streets to explore. All that remains is the town cemetery, filled with hundreds of identical metal crosses, each marking the grave of a brave miner who perished in the town's two tragedies. The crosses are sad reminders of what took place a century and more ago. Like these crosses, Nick Pappas's compelling new book will serve as a reminder for those who seek to learn how the strong, determined residents of a New Mexico community coped with recurring catastrophes, somehow recovering and managing to thrive for years to come. Richard Meltzer, co-author of A History of New Mexico Since Statehood. Preface. The bumpy road leading into Dawson, New Mexico is pretty desolate, to say the least. No homes, no businesses, no people. That doesn't change at the end of this unpaved 5.5-mile byway, where a metal gate with a no trespassing sign blocks entrance into a 50,000-acre tract of land that in its heyday was home to the largest company-owned town in the Southwest, and one with as macabre a history as the writings of Edgar Allan Poe. Consider. On October 22, 1913, 261 coal miners and two outside rescue men were killed in an explosion that stands today as the nation's second deadliest mine disaster. Some of the bodies were recovered in such a mangled state that they were buried, unidentified by colleagues or next of kin, in unmarked graves. A decade later, on February 8, 1923, another blast, the 16th worst mine disaster based on loss of life, claimed the lives of 120 men, some related by blood to men killed in 1913. All told, 521 men died from work-related injuries in the Dawson mines during the town's 49-year history. That figure doesn't include countless others who were disfigured or maimed in accidents that were far too common in U.S. mines in the early to mid-20th century. Today, the only hint of this forgotten place can be found a short walk from the locked gate in historic Dawson Cemetery, where rows of white iron crosses memorialize the nearly 400 miners killed in the 1913 and 1923 explosions. At its core, then, Crosses of Iron is a narrative recounting of the twin tragedies to befall Dawson, the only mining town in America to suffer two mishaps of this magnitude. Yet, the story involves so much more. It's the story of John Barclay Dawson, the fearless pioneer rancher and trailblazer who put down stakes on the land that years later would bear his name. It's the story of the model mining town that Phelps, Dodge & Company built there, a cosmopolitan community of roughly 6,000 souls that boasted a 1,000-seat opera house, excellent schools, two churches, a huge mercantile store that hosted fashion shows, a state-of-the-art hospital, and at 6,774 feet, the highest elevation golf course in the country at that time. It's the story of European immigrants from Austria, Finland, France, Germany, Great Britain, Greece, Ireland, Italy, Poland, Sweden, and other countries who came to Dawson in the early 1900s to seek better lives for themselves and their families. It's the story of the American labor movement and its at times bloody crusade to secure better working conditions for the nation's mine workers. U.S. labor organizer Dolores Huerta was born in Dawson. In the aftermath of the 1913 mine explosion, Luis Ticas, the Colorado labor leader who would be killed 6 months later in the Ludlow Massacre, sneaked into Dawson to commiserate with his fellow Greeks. It's the story of the closing of the last mine in 1950, when Dawson residents were given only a few months' notice to pack up their possessions. With few exceptions, all of the buildings, homes, and equipment were sold for parts, moved, or bulldozed into oblivion. It's the story of the rediscovery of Dawson Cemetery, courtesy of two brothers who stumbled upon the deteriorating graveyard while metal detecting decades later. One of the men made it his mission to work hand-in-hand with New Mexico officials to get the cemetery listed on the National Register of Historical Places and succeeded in 1992. And it's the story of thousands of folks who have kept the memory of Dawson alive through generations, reuniting every other Labor Day weekend to share stories, display mementos, exchange photographs, and relive memories of what it once meant to be a Dawsonite. For some families, it's not unusual to use these biennial visits to bury the cremated remains of their newly departed loved ones in the historic cemetery. So why is Dawson, New Mexico relevant today? Why spend 4 years researching and writing a book about a mining town that hasn't existed for more than half a century? Because Dawson still has an important tale to tell, one perhaps unmatched in breadth and scope by any other mining town in America. What's more, the themes of mining life that surfaced in the shadows of the Sangre de Cristo Mountains are as pertinent today as they were when Dawsonites faced not one, but two of the greatest calamities in the West's young history. Despair, faith, courage, fortitude, resilience, and a love of community unbroken to this very day. Crosses of Iron is that story. Chapter 1. Entombed. It was the impossible that happened, just another case of the unloaded gun which discharged. J.C. Roberts, U.S. Bureau of Mines, October 24, 1913. If the Dawson mines were ocean liners, they would have been deemed unsinkable. High-capacity fans chased out poisonous and explosive gases. A sophisticated fire protection system circulated water through miles of underground pipes to sprinklers and hoses. A state-of-the-art rescue station housed oxygen helmets, resuscitation devices, safety lamps, and other equipment. First aid teams drilled regularly and competed for prizes and medals in company-run competitions. Such was the reputation in 1913 of the Stag Canyon Fuel Company, which operated five coal mines tucked into the northeastern corner of New Mexico, not far from the Colorado border. Phelps, Dodge & Company of New York had purchased the fledgling mining community 8 years earlier from the Dawson Fuel Company, the first mining firm to punch ground-level tunnels into the spur of a mountain to ensure a steady stream of fuel for its copper smelting plants 600 miles to the west in southern Arizona. On the afternoon of October 22, 1913, Thomas T.H. O'Brien was in his office a mile from Mine No. 2, the company's most productive coal source a year earlier. The New York native looked more like a bank executive than the general manager of a Western coal company, with his slight build, boyish face, and round, rimless glasses. Yet, here he was, after cutting his teeth in the sooty mines of neighboring Colorado, presiding over what would soon become the largest company-owned town in the Southwest. Around 3 o'clock p.m., what sounded like the high-pitched crack of a rifle rattled O'Brien's eardrums. A muffled roar shook the floor beneath his feet. Outside his window, from the mouth of number two, a dragon-like tongue of flame spewed hundreds of feet into the sky before giving way to billowing clouds of dense black smoke. O'Brien activated the emergency siren, prompting workers from the adjacent mines to rush hellbent toward the smoldering number two. Much to their horror, they found the main entrance clogged with tons of debris. O'Brien ordered them to clear a path through the entryway. Then he and his crew made a beeline toward the air shaft, 1 mile north of the entrance and 250 feet deep, which contained a ladder and steps for such emergencies. But the air there was already saturated with poisonous gases, a surefire sign that the fan had been silenced by the ferocious force of the explosion. Undeterred, O'Brien and his men donned oxygen helmets and rushed inside mine number five, which shared a tunnel with the wrecked mine. Here, too, they found the passageway blocked. For O'Brien, the urgency became crystal clear. Unless rescue crews were able to break through the debris-filled entrance, and quickly, the death toll would be incomprehensible. Time was not on their side. The explosion had flattened the timber frames used to buttress the roof and sides of the mine, so rescue teams had to replace them as they went, step by step, piece by piece, lest they be crushed themselves. And that tedious work could be done only after clearing the avalanche of debris, coal, earth, rock, and timber that stretched from the entryway thousands of feet underground into the belly of the mine. Still, the rescuers persevered. By 10 o'clock p.m., 7 hours after the explosion, they had penetrated roughly 100 feet into the mine, deep enough to rescue five entombed miners. O'Brien was a beacon of hope and inspiration through it all. He recruited help from mining camps near and far, supervised the entrance work, even led rescue teams in the frantic search for the nearly 300 trapped miners. Until he couldn't. Some 24 hours after the explosion, having never paused to eat, at the brink of exhaustion, he collapsed while raising an oxygen helmet to his head to lead yet another rescue team into the mine. James J.C. Roberts, chief of the U.S. Bureau of Mines Rescue Station in the Denver-based Rocky Mountain District, learned of the Dawson incident from the Associated Press News Service at 8:30 p.m., some 5.5 hours after the explosion. He made plans to leave that night with a rescue car, one of the Bureau's fleet of converted Pullmans containing trained rescue crews and the finest equipment. Before departing, Roberts telegraphed for additional help from rescue cars stationed in Pittsburgh, Kansas, and Rock Springs, Wyoming. Rushing to a mine disaster was not new to Roberts, a 47-year-old former metallurgy professor at the Colorado School of Mines in Golden. When Congress established the Bureau in 1910 in response to a barrage of mine disasters, he became the district's go-to guy to lead the government's first response teams. In this role, Roberts already had witnessed enough heartache to last a lifetime. 79 bodies in Delagua, Colorado in 1910. 17 in Cokedale, Colorado in 1911. 7 in Kemmerer, Wyoming in 1912. Now this. Roberts and his team took command upon their arrival the next afternoon, but it wasn't long before he grasped the hopelessness of the rescue mission. One glimpse at the first bodies showed that they had been killed instantly by the violence of the explosion, or moments later by inhaling the dreaded black damp, a deadly mixture of carbon dioxide and nitrogen that permeated the mine after the fan was rendered inoperable by the blast. Roberts found one dead miner leaning against a wall, both hands raised as if trying to block a punch to the jaw. Another was standing, pick in hand, as if he had struck his last blow into the coal. For some families, the procedure for identifying the dead, or what remained of them, only deepened their anguish. If a deceased miner could not be identified with certainty by mine officials, wives and relatives were ushered into an old company store converted by grim necessity into a makeshift morgue. Here, amid the eye-watering stench of decomposition, they were given mere seconds to determine if the disfigured or mutilated body lying before them was a father, a husband, a son, a brother, an uncle, a cousin. The corpses that defied identification would be buried in the town cemetery under nameless iron crosses. Dr. James Douglas, president of Phelps Dodge, was 600 miles away in his namesake town of Douglas, Arizona. He boarded a special train with Walter Douglas, his elder son and the company's general manager, and arrived on the morning of October 24, 2 days after the incident. Douglas was no bean-counting figurehead. A brilliant metallurgist and mining engineer by trade, the Canadian-born son of a prominent Scottish surgeon had been recruited by Phelps Dodge as a consultant in 1881 after he earned national acclaim for his pioneering work in the extraction of copper from its ores. By the time Douglas became president in 1908, Phelps Dodge was well into its transformation from an old New York-based mercantile company into a copper mining juggernaut of international renown. Still, the long train ride could not have prepared father and son for what awaited them. Helmeted rescue men in regular shifts of 15, trudging out of the mine with stretchers bearing the hidden remains of miners. Mothers and wives, only yards from the charred entrance, pressed up against hastily erected ropes to prevent them from interfering with rescuers. A steady stream of empty coffins, arriving by the trainload from as far away as Colorado and Texas, ticketed for the morgue. This wasn't the first visit to Dawson for the 75-year-old Douglas, who was called doctor out of respect, even though he had never completed his medical degree. He had spent many days here negotiating the purchase of the mines in 1905, and had made frequent trips in the ensuing years, even journeying deep inside the tunnels, despite his advancing age. This time, he kept to administrative work, sparing no expense to procure the best rescue equipment available. His son, meanwhile, spent much of his time inside the mine, aiding the rescue work and leading efforts to clear the air of dangerous gases. Both arrived just in time for the first funerals. Town supervisor Thaddeus T.L. Kinney was quick to set up a relief camp a few yards from the mine entrance, where survivors and overextended rescuers could find rest and medical care. But the 40-year-old Indiana native had another critical assignment. In keeping with Phelps Dodge's strict anti-union philosophy, he was charged with making sure labor agitators from nearby coal camps did not gain entry into Dawson under any circumstances, even to assist in the rescue of their fellow miners. That's precisely what happened to Edward L. Doyle, Secretary-Treasurer of the Colorado-based District 15 of the United Mine Workers of America. Doyle was so irate over his treatment at the rail yard that he fired off an angry telegram to U.S. Representative Edward E. Keating of Colorado 2 days later. Went to Dawson to offer financial assistance to those in distress and was driven out by coal companies' mounted police, he wrote. Hundreds of miners still entombed. Action, a disgrace to civilization. Later, the United Mine Workers Journal published a more colorful account of the incident. Men from the neighboring mines came to this privately owned town intending to render what assistance they could by aiding in the work of rescue and to proffer financial assistance to the families of the victims. But they were met at the railroad station by the camp marshals and forced to walk, at the muzzle of a rifle, 6 miles, to the end of the private holdings of this company. In Dawson speak, they were kicked down the canyon. Rees H. Beto, New Mexico's first mine inspector after its admission into the Union in 1912, knew the Stag Canyon mines well. In fact, he had left Dawson just days before the explosion after wrapping up his inspection of all 5 mines. During his 2-day examination of mine number 2, conducted on October 15 and 16, he took a headcount of workers underground, examined the ventilation system, and sent an air sample to the U.S. Bureau of Mines to test for levels of methane, which can be deadly in high concentrations in coal mines. The 54-year-old inspector found little to dispute the conventional wisdom of the day among mining experts, the Dawson mines were among the safest in the country. In his annual report to the governor, submitted 6 weeks after the explosion, Beddoe wrote that the mine was a modern one in every respect. Its ventilation system was well planned. Its equipment was first class. And the company's shot firing system, used to dislodge coal inside the mines, cannot be beaten. Beddoe did flag the presence of highly flammable coal dust, the fine powder generated by the crushing or grinding of coal. The dust had already played a major role in coal mine disasters around the world, including the second worst on record, at Courrières in northern France in 1906, which claimed the lives of 1,099 miners. While Beddoe acknowledged that the amount of coal dust necessary to feed an explosion was open to debate, he found a worrisome amount throughout the mine, due in part to New Mexico's dry climate. "In this dust lies the greatest danger to the operation of mines," he wrote. "And there is no doubt in my mind that the dust problem will be given more serious consideration, and that the most approved remedies for this danger will be applied. If not," he warned, "he would push for stricter laws to help him deal with the problem." Beddoe was 150 miles away in the capital city of Santa Fe on the afternoon of the explosion. After conferring with the governor, he left for Dawson at 9 o'clock p.m. and arrived the next morning. By 7 o'clock a.m., he was inside the corpse-filled mine. Governor William C. McDonald was no stranger to coal mines, having worked as a mining engineer in White Oaks, New Mexico, before entering state politics 30 years earlier. The 55-year-old Democrat made it known that the state was prepared to offer assistance, financial or otherwise, to aid the victims' families. The American Red Cross reached out, too. By noon the day after the explosion, Dr. S.P. Morris, a representative from the district office, had arrived in Dawson to help. National Director General Ernest P. Bicknell also informed McDonald that he could count on a donation of $1,000 to help ease the suffering of the miners' families. Both offers were appreciated, but declined by Phelps Dodge officials, who assured the governor and the relief agency that the company would take care of its own. It would make good on that promise, paying for the burials and making lump sum payments of roughly $1,000, the equivalent of about $30,000 today, to each widow, and $100 to each child of the deceased miners. Mine Superintendent William McDermott was riding toward the mines on horseback 2 hours before the explosion when he spotted Tim Tinsley up ahead. Tinsley, a veteran coal miner, had come out of retirement in neighboring Colorado 3 years earlier to become foreman of the Dawson mines. Tinsley told McDermott he was on his way to mine number 2 to check on an injured worker. McDermott, well into his first year as superintendent, said he wanted to speak to the pit boss about the accident, so he instructed Tinsley to take care of some business in the number 1 mine instead. McDermott was still in the mine when it exploded. Ultimately, the official death toll was set at 263, 261 trapped miners, and 2 rescue men from an outside coal camp, making it the second deadliest mine disaster in U.S. history. 2/3 of the dead were recent immigrants from Italy and Greece. Only 23 men survived. 3 weeks after the explosion, Kenny, the town supervisor who doubled as a judge, swore in 6 men chosen to participate in the coroner's inquest. Their charge? To determine, in the words of County Attorney George E. Rimley, whether or not the victim's death was caused by a crime of any person or persons. And if so, by whom? Chapter 2. The Birth of Dawson. I went sometimes without the necessaries of life. I used my rifle and fishhook many times to keep from going hungry. The blazed trail is nearly finished. I hewed the way for my children. The way has much improved. I shall leave it to you to see the improvement. I will not attempt to describe it. John Barclay Dawson. Autobiographical Notes, 1912. There would have been no Dawson, at least in name, without John Barclay Dawson. Cattle driver, farmer, Pioneer, Rancher, Texas Ranger, Trailblazer. Coal baron? Hardly. Dawson's primary use for the surface coal scattered about his ranch was to keep his family comfortable during those frosty New Mexico winters. The coal, it turned out, burned longer than wood inside his wood stove. J.B. Dawson was born on November 10, 1830, in Grayson County, Kentucky, the only son of Thomas and Letitia de Graffenried Dawson. His grandfather served in the 1st Virginia Regiment during the American Revolution and married Mary Ann Clay, a relative of American statesman Henry Clay. Dawson grew up to be a man of indisputable character, a trait that would serve him well years later when he was the defendant in a land eviction proceeding that reached the U.S. Supreme Court. Based on a story he was fond of reciting to his children and grandchildren, that character was put to the test at an early age. As recounted by his granddaughter, Delphine Dawson Wilson, Dawson's parents sent him out to hunt wild game to put some food on the table, not an uncommon chore for a 9-year-old of that day. But poor John got lost. Tracking the sound of axe striking wood, he spied a cabin where a father and son were chopping down trees. As the story goes, John arrived around mealtime, and the man invited him to stay. Inside, John counted 10 children around the table, each with an eye on some small baked potatoes, roughly 18 in all. It didn't take long for him to do the math. Even though he had yet to eat that day, a famished John chose only 2 tiny ones for his plate. "Take 3, stranger. Take dang nigh all of 'em, stranger," the man shouted at him. John started to reach for another until he caught the anxious look on the children's faces. Recognizing that this family was more destitute than his own, he pulled back. John was shown the way home, where he not only found himself hungry, but with nothing to feed his family. Whether he got a good whipping when he got home is open to conjecture. After spending 6 or 7 years in southwestern Missouri, in 1840 the Dawson family moved near Fort Smith, Arkansas, nestled along the Arkansas River near the Oklahoma border. Since its founding in 1817, Fort Smith had developed into a key supply post for U.S. soldiers, and before long, John's father had secured a government contract to furnish hay to the military men stationed there. These were prosperous times for the Dawson family, which by now had expanded to include kinfolk and friends. Near the end of the decade, however, Fort Smith underwent a historic transformation, kick-started by the discovery of gold at the base of California's Sierra Nevada mountains. Within a year, it became a popular supply center not just for the military, but also for 49ers lured westward by the promise of riches. These prospectors did not include the Dawson family, at least not at first. It would be another 4 years before Thomas, Letitia, John, and his younger sister Henrietta left Fort Smith behind to travel by ox team to California. While their precise route is not known, John's brief account suggests that they crossed the Platte River in Colorado, hoofed it through what is now Denver, then passed through Salt Lake City on their way to their final destination. That turned out to be Rough and Ready, a scrappy mining town that had wasted no time in carving out a permanent, if somewhat dubious, place in U.S. history. Furious over California's imposition of a mining tax, townspeople voted in 1850 to secede and form the Great Republic of Rough and Ready, complete with constitution, president, and cabinet. That early experiment in self-governance lasted less than 3 months, ending appropriately enough on the 4th of July. By at least one account, the townsfolk scrambled to rejoin the Union after several residents were denied the purchase of celebratory alcohol in nearby Nevada City because they were foreigners. The Dawson family's stay in Rough and Ready was less dramatic. In fact, after only 2 years out west, they pulled up stakes and headed back to Arkansas. For John, now 25, the experience proved to be life-changing. By the time the family reached home, he knew what he wanted to do. returned to California not in search of gold, but as a driver of cattle. The California gold rush had taken a toll on the wild game on which miners in the Sierra Nevada foothills relied for food. In this, Dawson saw opportunity. In 1855, he set off on another journey across the continent, this time with an estimated 400 head of cattle. He was accompanied by relatives and friends, and secure in his knowledge of the trail. Few details exist about Dawson's maiden cattle drive. Not the route, not the breed of cattle, not the length of his trip, not any close calls with bandits or natives. In Dawson's typical understated way, this is how he described that experience 30 years later. I returned to California in the fall of 1855. I drove a herd of cattle from Arkansas to California and located at the Butte Mountains near Marysville. I remained there until the fall of 1857. I sold out my stock and returned to Arkansas, where my parents were. That the trip was a financial success is beyond dispute. A year later, on the recommendation of legendary frontiersman Kit Carson, Dawson and his father obtained 1,000 acres of prime cattle grazing land about 400 miles to the west in Fort Belknap, Texas. It would be here that Dawson would establish himself as one of the premier cattle drivers of his generation. By this time, Dawson had learned that gold had been discovered in the Rocky Mountains of Colorado, sparking what would become known as the Colorado Gold Rush. Between 1858 and 1861, an estimated 100,000 people flocked to Pikes Peak, roughly halfway between present-day Pueblo and Denver. While these 59ers dreamed of lining their pockets with gold, Dawson was more interested in stuffing their bellies with beef. He headed north with a herd of cattle, sticking closely to the trail he had blazed years earlier on his way to California. In time, a version of this route would become known as the Dawson Trail. That cattle drive would be the first of many Dawson would lead, either on his own or with partners, into the wilderness of Colorado, New Mexico, and Wyoming. At times, he trailed as many as 6,000 head to sell to miners, government outposts, and even random travelers along the way. These drives, coupled with some shrewd investments in cattle companies in New Mexico in the early 1880s, would go a long way toward making Dawson a wealthy man. This is not to say that his life was without hardship. Nowhere was that more evident than in his love life. Dawson met the woman who would become his first wife in 1861. As the story goes, he and his best friend Tom Stockton were walking the streets of San Antonio, Texas, when Dawson was struck by the prettiest music I'd ever heard coming from a nearby balcony. Reaching for his boot, Dawson pulled out his knife and jimmied the corner of a shuttered window to see who was responsible for the piano playing and song. She turned out to be Tom's half-sister, Edwina Stockton. The two were married months later. John was 30 years old, 10 years older than his new bride when the newlyweds settled in Fort Belknap. Edwina bore him a child, a son named Augustus Green Dawson, in December 1862, but she fell ill and died a year later, possibly from complications related to the birth. In the aftermath of Edwina's death, Dawson's life, in the words of his granddaughter, was thrown out of focus. This may explain why he and Stockton, Edwina's half-brother, joined the Texas Rangers in 1864, 3 years after Texas seceded to join the Confederate States of America. Dawson's only written account isn't much help. My wife died December 1, 1863. I joined the Texas Rangers where we had to serve 1/4 of our time. We were organized to protect the frontier of Texas. The service was exclusively for the state in watching and keeping the bands of wandering Indians and Mexicans out. I remained a member of the Rangers for 4 years. The only record of this service is a story he shared through the years with family and friends. One retelling came some 40 years later, in 1906, in the presence of Charles Goodnight, a fellow cattle rancher and close friend, and journalist Hatton W. Sumners. goodnight cajoled Dawson into telling Summers about the fight on Paint Creek. Based on Sumner's published account, natives raided Dawson's Fort Belknap neighborhood and killed a young boy. Dawson, Stockton, and four others tracked them on horseback for 125 miles, killing one before the rest escaped. On their return home the next day, just before sundown, they came across another six natives on horseback, one a boy of about 17, driving a team of what they surmised to be stolen horses. The ensuing confrontation left four natives dead and another badly wounded. When the teenaged boy realized he could do nothing to help his wounded companion, he headed straight toward Dawson, bow and arrow in hand, to avenge his death. "He was coming straight for me. I shot him with a rifle." Tom Stockton and Elias Hale were shooting at him with six-shooters. The boy had on a loose shirt, and I could see the pistol bullets drive the shirt into his body as the bullets went true. But they could not stop him. The men who were shooting at him with their pistols were kneeling down. The Indian was coming erect, straight for me. He got so close to us that Stockton and Hale moved back, and I started to mount my horse. When he saw me doing this, he mounted one of our horses and met me face to face about 10 steps apart. We both started to shoot almost at the same time, I with my pistol, he with his bow. He was a little quicker than I was, and his arrow went into my right hand as I was aiming my pistol at him, and into the lock on my pistol, disabling it and rendering me helpless. Just as he was getting another arrow, with which he would no doubt have killed me, George Baylor shot him with a shotgun, and he fell from the horse, dead. When we looked at his body, we found he had one rifle wound and 9 pistol wounds, besides the wound made by the shotgun. There were no wounds in his arms or legs. His shirt was as bloody as if it had been dipped in blood. Sumner's account of Dawson's near brush with death ends here, though family members say Dawson invariably ended his telling of this story by heaping praise on the young native as the bravest man I ever met. Shortly after partnering with a few men to purchase ranch land along the Vermejo River in New Mexico, Dawson met schoolteacher Laura Stout in Veal Station, Texas. They married in September 1868. This marriage, too, would end in hardship. Shortly after giving birth to his third son, while her husband was away on business, Laura came down with a fever and died, less than 4 years after their wedding day. John was now in his early 40s, and with the arrival of sons Syria Milton and Abner Bruce, the father of 3 motherless boys. The search for wife number 3 turned out to be no less adventurous than one of Dawson's patented cattle drives. Eager to find a new mother for his 3 boys, now 9, 2, and 2 months in age, Dawson turned to family and friends for some matchmaking. After someone spoke highly of a widow in Trinidad, Colorado, Dawson boarded a stagecoach to go and meet her. He didn't get far. Dawson picked up a Baptist magazine left on board and noticed an article written by a Lavinia Jefferson of Middletown, Iowa. At the next stop, a mere 25 miles into the journey, Dawson stepped off and caught the next stagecoach home. Using his rudimentary writing skills, perhaps with some assistance, he crafted a letter to the next Mrs. John Barclay Dawson, or so he hoped. He told her he liked her article. He told her he was 42 years old and in good health. He told her about his motherless children, and he told her he would like to meet. With that, he mailed the letter to the magazine, hoping that someone would forward it to her. No doubt many women would have crumpled the stranger's letter and tossed it into the nearest trash heap. Not Lavinia. There was something about it that persuaded this unmarried 31-year-old schoolteacher to reply. She would be willing to meet with him, she wrote, but only if he waited a year. After all, his second wife had died only months earlier. Still, they corresponded for a time. Before long, Dawson was on his way to Iowa to meet her. When he got off the train that night, the station agent asked him if he was the person who had been writing to the widow Jefferson's daughter. When Dawson acknowledged he was the one, The agent told him, "You know, you couldn't do better and marry that girl. Her mother has an acre of good pasture land and a fine Jersey cow." With that, Dawson checked into a hotel for the night. The pair's morning visit was cut short because Lavinia wasn't feeling well. After this forgettable first meeting, Dawson returned a second time to find her in much better health. A whirlwind courtship culminated in her walking down the aisle of her Baptist church, accompanied by this handsome, well-set-up man with neatly trimmed beard and mustache. The wedding took place on March 28, 1873, less than a year after the death of Dawson's second wife, Laura. "I went as did Rebecca of old, nothing doubting," she wrote years later. "We were married. I bade farewell to home, sister, friends, and went to that faraway land I thought so little of a few months before." Once Lavinia reached the Dawson ranch, no one would have blamed her if she had climbed back onto the buckboard wagon and headed home to Iowa. It was not long before she had her first taste of what her life was about to become as a member of the Dawson family. She met John's parents. She met the parents of John's second wife. She met two brothers of John's first wife, one of whom was married to the sister of John's second wife. She met John's partners in the cattle business, one of whom was married to John's cousin, and so on, all living on the sprawling Dawson ranch. Lavinia not only stayed, but did her part to expand the family even more. Manly Mortimer, Dawson's fourth son, was born the next year, 1874, followed by another boy, Jefferson Leo, in 1876, and yet another, John Barclay II, in 1878. The run of boys ended with the arrival of Edwina in 1880 and Laura in 1882, both named by John after his first wives without seeking Lavinia's consent. Henry Miller Dawson became the last of John's nine children upon his birth in 1886. But Lavinia did much more than help populate the ranch with little Dawsons. With her husband away much of the time on business and cattle drives, she became a key partner and administrator, starting with the introduction of her Jersey cow and fresh milk for family and neighbors. Life was good for this frontier family, until it wasn't. Dawson was just a boy in 1841 when the Mexican government bestowed a leaf-shaped 1.7 million acre tract of land to Mexican citizens Carlos Bobien and Guadalupe Miranda, the largest such tract in U.S. history. After a series of legal disputes over the legitimacy and boundaries of the grant, the majority in what is now northwestern New Mexico, the property found its way into the hands of Lucien Maxwell, Bobien's son-in-law. In 1870, he became the sole owner of what became known as the Maxwell Land Grant. Enter Dawson, brother-in-law Joel Curtis, cousin Dick Miller, and business partner Taylor Malding. In 1869, they reached an agreement with Maxwell to purchase a loosely defined tract of land along the Vermejo River for $3,700. Prior to signing the deed, Dawson met with Maxwell on the property, pointed out the boundaries of the parcel as he understood them, and sealed the deal with a handshake. The purchase became official on January 7, 1869, clearing the way for Dawson and his family to move from Texas to their new home in the New Mexico Territory. 15 months later, Maxwell sold the remainder of the land grant to a Colorado senator and his partners, backed by an English syndicate, for $1.35 million. One of the first acts of the Maxwell Land Grant and Railway Company was to order the settlers whom Maxwell had permitted to occupy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.